And the Supervisor Richard Forster with your report from our board meeting of October 8th, 2013. First up, we had three abatement hearings, and these are cases that come before code enforcement. The board does not like to do this. We don't like to come down on people with the hard hammer, but you know what? In some instances, you need to. These people have been worked with for an extended period of time to try to come into compliance, and either for obstinance, for financial reasons or other, they have not come into compliance. First case is Belleville Wilson, and this is a case on Latrobe Road, a property there that has a septic system that was installed without permits, installed incorrectly, and therefore the septic system is leaching to the surface where it can provide contamination to humans, to animals, and just not a good situation. I got to tell you, there on this property, there have been numerous code enforcement violations, and Linda Van Vleck from code enforcement has worked with Ms. Wilson trying to bring her into compliance on these issues, and all the way from living quarters that where a barn was converted without any permits to trash on the property, and just one thing after another. You know, one person can cost the county and you as a taxpayer a lot of money. So, you know, we need to try and bring these people into compliance, and we're working with them, but at some point you bring the hammer down. In this case, what happened from the code enforcement board, which is Louis Boitano was the chair of that, Joe Lowe, our county auditor, was a member, and Captain Brian Middleton was also a member. So three-person board. They go through, we have legal representation there, we have code enforcement there, so we have land use there sometimes, we have many different departments, environmental health, and cost the county, and because it costs the county, it costs you as a taxpayer a lot of money to go through this, but you have to actually come up with findings of law. You have to make, the board makes, three-member board makes recommendations to the Board of Supervisors, and then normally they stay that recommendation. The initial recommendation is usually in these types of cases that the people vacate the property within 48 hours. They stay that, and in this case, they're allowing Ms. Wilson to put in a gray water system prior to putting in the actual septic system that needs to happen within a certain period of time, too. There's timelines built into this. If she does not meet those timelines, then we're back to code enforcement and going to court to basically evict her from her property. The other issue here is that the timelines need to be met, but if in the meantime, and we're giving her several years to come up with the resources to make to put in a conventional system, if that does not happen, or in the meantime, if the effluent surfaces again, if she doesn't comply with the gray water storage with pumping that tank out, then here comes code enforcement again, and here comes the eviction process. So at some point, like I said, you put the hammer down. Same case with this next one, the Gibson Family Revocable Trust. This is up in the Pine Grove area. And I got to say, all these people are trying to comply a little bit too late, but they're trying to comply now. In this case, Ms. Gibson, who is not the property owner, the property actually belongs to her brother through a trust. She has actually moved off the property already, but what they have in this case is a open wooden septic tank. Now, that's about as old as you can get. It's the way they did it many years ago. It's not the way we do it today. It provides an access for people and animals, especially animals, to get into that septic tank and spread disease from there. So in this case, the same thing was done. She was going to be told to vacate the property within 48 hours. That was stayed. She has remedied that already because she has already left the property. She wants to come back at some point, but they've already made arrangements to drain the septic tank, to destroy the old wooden septic tank, cover that up, put rock in and everything else. And at some point, she wants to come back and get that property in shape, put a new septic system in so she can live there, so because she was happy on the property. But she's got to remedy that issue working with her brother, who we found out another little snag during the process, may want to sell the property. This next case, the West End Consortium, Mark McMaster was representing there. His argument was that, and this involves a sign issue on Highway 16 for Serafina Winery and for the West End Consortium, which includes Tannis Vineyards, New Adair, and some others. Drytown Cellars, I think, was one other one. But in this case, his argument was this is a mobile sign. Well, County Council, Deputy County Council McGee informed him that, well, we don't have mobile as part of our ordinance, and our ordinance is old, but on the other hand, that sign has been parked there for a year, so it's really not mobile. So that didn't fly. They have removed the trailer and the signage at this point. The problem is there's three other signs out there that don't have anything to do with this that the county's going to have to deal with. The issue is big here. We need to come back and redo our sign ordinance, try to make some sense out of it. These people are in a catch-22. They have no place to really advertise their property big enough for people to see when they're going 65 miles an hour down the road. I do agree with my fellow board members, though. We don't want signs all over the county. Otherwise, we're going to look like any place else that people can go in urban and suburban areas. Our sign ordinance does need to be updated because, as Mr. McMaster pointed out, it does not jive with the Caltrans sign ordinance in the least bit. Other things that came up yesterday, Rabbit Creek, which is out on Comanche North, Comanche Parkway North, will be shut down for up to 4 days for about 10-hour days. This will happen sometime between October 23rd and November 6th. Board gave authorization here. Big thing is I want to give credit to Aaron Bruce-Torrey, our community resources manager, who community development department manager, who took this project from $400,000 in cost down to $80,000 by using a little out-of-the-box creative thinking that satisfied all the requirements. The board did have discussion on City of Jackson and the sphere of influence discussion that's going before LAFCO. It's already been through one meeting. We'll come back on the 17th of October. Jackson has been talking to LAFCO, and according to Roseanne Chamberlain, executive officer of LAFCO, she's actually the one that is required every 5 years to review this. You look at the service areas, who is providing service, but other people had issues with this. John Kirkpatrick just wants to be left alone, I think. But Terry Nielsen looked at this as a land grab by the City of Jackson for the tax revenue. So anyway, that's all the time I have. 223-6470 if you have anything to come before the board or talk to us about things. And this is Supervisor Richard Forster. We'll talk to you in a couple weeks. We are going to a break right now.
You're watching Amador County's local television network, TSPN.